الأمانة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين. تركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. And I bear witness that there is no God worthy the worshipping except Allah, the One, the Sufficient Master. He begots not, nor He was begotten. And there is none co equal nor comparable unto Him. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last and the final messenger of Allah. He sent him to us with the message of Islam. And he struggled so hard and exercised jihad in the true meanings of jihad to ensure that what we have today in our hands is the last and the final message from Allah. عباد الله أوصيكم ونفس المقصرة بتقوى الله وأذركم ونفس من عصيانه ومخالفة أمره لزوما لقوله الحق تبارك وتعالى في كتابه الكريم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون وكذلك في قول الحق تبارك وتعالى يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا اتقوا الله فإنه من لا يتقي ربه فإن له معيشة ضنكا ويحشر يوم القيامة أعمى فيقول ربي لم حشرتني أعمى وقد كنت بصيرا فيقال كذلك أتتك آياتنا فنسيتها وكذلك اليوم تنسى. I began by encouraging you and myself first of all to fulfill the commands of Allah. And I warned you and myself first of all from disobeying Him. According to Him telling us in the Quran, O mankind, fear the Lord. The one who created you from one soul and created its mate from it and created from them so many men and women. And fear your Lord, by whose name you demand your mutual rights from one another. And fear your Lord, by observing the right of your blood tie relatives, your rahim. Fear your Lord, as those who do not fear Allah would live a miserable life. And would be resurrected blind in the hereafter. And when the crying complain, why are we resurrected blind when we used to see in our life? The answer comes to them that the ayat of Allah came on you and you ignored it. And that's why you would be ignored. My dear brothers and sisters, we are in Shahrullah al-Haram. And we have, throughout this month, had so many significant events. We had the Ashura, the 10th of Muharram, which many of us have observed to be able to gain the maghfirah of the whole year. And we are mindful that this is the beginning of our Hijri calendar. And we are mindful that this is Shahrullah al-Haram, the month of Allah, forbidden, meaning to say that the hurumat in this month is highly forbidden by Allah, as well as to be said for the ibadat throughout this month that are highly rewarded by Allah Azza wa Jal. Because we do have opportunities and chances throughout the year, starting from the month of Dhul Qa'dah, Dhul Hijjah, and then Muharram, those are Ashhur al-Hurum. And then we wait until the next, inshallah, Rajab, to be preparing ourselves for the month of Ramadan. And throughout this month, we did have also challenging events for us as Muslims living in this part of the world. And allow me in today's khutbah to take an unusual approach, as I normally do, to address issues that are essential to be addressed to us as a community. And this is the chance for us to do it as a congregation and be mindful about and deal with it. These are the issues of mental health and addictions, which many of us live in denial that we do not have these issues as concern for us as a community. And the incidents we had in the last 2 weeks is a clear demonstration to why we should be mindful of this, of these issues in our life. And Allah Azza wa Jal have described to us that لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمِ, that we created man in the best form, shape and manner. But at the same time, he also addressed the fact that we have been honored among others, other creations of His by the intellect, by the mind, by the ability to intellectually be able to deal and interact with the surroundings. And that's why Allah Azza wa Jal have asked the Malaika to make sujood of honor to Adam alayhi salam after he passed the test of intellect, the intellectual test, the test of intelligence, that he demonstrated that he has the ability to intellectually deal with the surroundings around him. And Allah Azza wa Jal at the same time have alluded to us about the fact that we are susceptible as a human being for the sickness of the body. As what happened to the story of Ayyub alayhi salam, إِنِّ مَسَّنِيَ الشَّيْطَانُ بُنُصْبٍ وَعَذَابٍ. As we all know, the story of Yusuf, of Ayyub, clearly demonstrate what the mu'min is subjugated to in his life or her life as a result of being chosen by Allah to be tested. And the test of physical sickness could be severe as what happened in the life of Ayyub alayhi salam. But along with that also comes the emotional and intellectual tests. مَسَّنِيَ الشَّيْطَانُ بِنُصْبٍ وَعَذَابٍ. And when you explore the meaning of the ayat, نُصْبٍ وَعَذَابٍ, you would find that this is referring primarily to the emotional endowment and heaviness of what Ayyub alayhi salam was going through as a result of his physical sickness. As a result of our physical sickness, we could be challenged emotionally or spiritually, and we could go through difficult time. And this is when Ayyub alayhi salam raised his hand to Allah or supplicated to Allah Azza wa Jal to give him the empowerment. And if you even go further in the tafasir of what مَسَّنِيَ الشَّيْطَانُ بِنُصْبٍ وَعَذَابٍ, it would say that shaitan used to come by Ayyub alayhi salam and criticize him and say, do you call yourself, you claim to be a prophet of Allah? Why would Allah be doing this to you if you were to be his prophet? And Ayyub alayhi salam, the prophet of Allah, the one whom Allah Azza wa Jal have revealed to, used to respond and defeat shaitan by telling him, if you were to know the happiness I am living in, being with Allah Azza wa Jal, you would not say what you're saying. And this is what we sometimes would go through or feel as we go through difficulties and challenges in our life. Whether it is physical or emotional or intellectual, we're being an easy target of the shaitan. And this comes the understanding of these issues in our life. In the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal have addressed the issues of mental sicknesses to us. كالذي مسه الشيطان كالذي اتخبطوا يا أيها الذين آمنوا تأكلوا الربا and كالذي اتخبطوا خبطه الشيطان من المس. Allah referred to those who are engaged in riba actions, the illegal actions, financial actions, are like those who are being اتخبطه الشيطان من المس. They are being an easy target of the shaitan. And they have the what we call nowadays the mental sickness or the schizophrenia as it is defined sometimes in the science terms. So Allah Azza wa Jal also have referred to the huzn. وَلَا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي إِنَّا رَادُّوهُ إِلَيْكِ وَجَاعِلُوهُ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ فَنَادَاهَا مِنْ تَحْتِهَا أَلَّا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي وَكُلِي وَشْرَبِي وَقَرِّي عَيْنًا. All these emotional and intellectual status of the mind have been presented to us in the Quran so that we are mindful about who we are as a human being and how Allah created us and how we need to be, how we need to deal with the challenges we go through in our life. The mental sickness is exactly similar to the physical sickness. And when we go through physical sickness, we wait for others to help us be able to deal with it. When we go to see physicians and get the medications, and we need this extra support from those who are around us to be able to go through this difficult time of physical sickness, the same is to be said when it comes to mental sickness and addiction. And here comes also another frontier that unfortunately we in the Muslim community have a big deficit when it comes to dealing with addiction. We live in taboo. We live in denial. There are Muslim children and new Muslims who are involved into the addiction problems, and they're always been rejected and misperceived by the community. Just a few days before the incident that took place in Arawa, I happened to be in one of the masajid in Toronto, one of the big masajids in Toronto, where a new Muslim was walking in smelling. And everyone, including the imam, wants to kick that person outside because he smells. And I said, Subhanallah, are you kicking someone from the masjid who's coming to worship Allah Azza wa Jal and standing between the hands of Allah? Who are you? Who are you to reject this person and kick him outside from the house of Allah? Who are you to do so? When the man who is known in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his nickname was Himaran, and translated in Arabic as donkey or ass. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to enjoy his company. He used to come and entertain the Prophet, and the Prophet would laugh when he's around for his jokes. He was alcoholic, and he was brought many times to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would punish him in the proper way to make him feel that whatever he is doing is wrong. But yet at the same time, told one of the Sahaba who cursed him and said, La'natullahi alayk, the curse of Allah be on you. The Prophet ﷺ said to him, hold on. Well, I know him that he loves Allah and his Prophet. I know him that he loves Allah and his Prophet. You should not be cursing him. You should not be on the side of shaitan against him. And that's what we need to be mindful of. If you are aware of a person, whether it's a family member of yours, or a neighbor, or a member of the community, who has been a victim of addiction, then you need not to be on the side of shaitan against him, but rather to be on his side against the shaitan, so that you're able to properly bring him back to the boundaries of the deen of Allah. And in difficult situations and circumstances, our tendency as a human being would be that we turn to spirituality, quote-unquote, to get the empowerment and to feel the comfort. And this is what happened to most of the members of the community who do have challenges and difficulties in their life. Sometimes when you go to certain masajids and a person who has the look of being a quote-unquote harmless would be looked down when they are walked into the masjid. And everybody will be so protective about their belongings, and they put them in front of them, and they give this down look to the person. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. Why are you doing this, ya akhi? Why are you doing this to someone who's coming to the whole house, to the house of Allah Azza wa Jal? Rather than opening your heart to them, and welcoming them, and assist them if needed financially or emotionally, so that they're able to deal with their own challenges. You're giving them this down look and remote them, so that they will be further subjugated to shaitan's influence. This is not how we deal with issues in Islam. Allah Azza wa Jal have addressed the issues of addiction to us in the Quran. When the Prophet ﷺ was asked about al-khamr, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَلَى الْخَمْرِ قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعٌ وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْعِهِمَا. Allah Azza wa Jal asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to respond that yes, indeed, khamr is indeed an addiction. It's a problem. فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعٌ. In it is a big madarra, a big problem, big ithm, yet with a small benefit. And that's what we need to speak out clearly and loudly. As a community who has been labeled always as being a community that associated with terrorism. And we need to speak up and loudly and say, do not label Islam and Muslims as terrorists. We have been victims since September 11, 2001, and up to nowadays,
Because there seem to be a group of individuals who have an agenda that take advantages always whenever something wrong happened. Our sympathy goes to the family of the soldiers who fall when he was protecting our dignity and honor as Canadians in our capital. And I'm a person who have felt the sympathy for the family. But at the same time, I am standing up and firm and defending our community. This is nonsense that every time something wrong happens, we attack and subjugate Islam to being a victim. This morning, there was in the news about a person who was a former soldier working with the intelligence services, or the military intelligence service, who had a plan to attack a building in downtown Calgary. The news was slightly mentioned in 6 o'clock in the morning, and nothing was repeated at noon prime time of the day. Why? Why do we have double standards when it comes with looking at whatever problems we have in our society? Why do we always take chances and opportunities to attack Islam and Muslims when the things are taken out of proportion? Why is that? Clearly, the person who have committed this awful crime in Ottawa is a mental health addiction person. The news we receive in different news outlets speaks about the history of this person being a drug addict. He's a drug addict with mental health problems, as his mother have addressed. And as a result of what he have, as a result of his frustration, and as a result of the narrow-minded system that deals with issues in our society, this person's react out of proportion, and he did it as an individual. Nothing to do with the faith of Islam. As a matter of the fact, he sought refuge in Islam when he accepted Islam and came to the masjid looking for help. But at the same time, unfortunately, the Muslim community was also narrow-minded. When he went to the mosque where he used to attend, he was kicked out from the mosque several times. Why is that happening to us? Is it not yet time for us to wake up and realize that when someone reaches out for the mosque, whether he's a born Muslim or a new Muslim with difficulties and challenges, is it not yet the time for us to say, welcome, we're here to help you. We're here to be part of the solution rather than being part of the problem in your life. That's what we need to do. And that's what we need to empower our masajid for. And that's what we need to empower our centers for. To be a hub, to be a center, welcoming all people of different faith and cultural background to come and seek help and support. And this is the most effective way of dealing with mental health and addiction problems in any society in general. وأقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه فيا فوز المستغفرين. الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا وسيئات اعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. يسالونك عن الخمر قل فيهما اثم كبير ومنافع واثمهما اكبر من نفعهما. Yes indeed, there is small benefit, financial benefit or economic benefit that we do have. Our alcohol beverages are run by our government. That's a big shame. And I'm speaking up, and I'm not afraid of speaking up, because when our government run the stores that provide the beverages that cause the addiction to certain individuals in our society, and when we know that our own tax money that we pay is going to support programs to fight addiction, we say to them, is it not that time to wake up to the reality that alcohol is a problem? Early in the last century, alcohol was forbidden both in the U.S. and Canada because of the fact that alcohol is a source of so many problems. It's the source of violence, it's the source of crimes, it's the source of so many things. This is a conclusion that was reached early in the last century, but things have changed lately because of economic motivation from certain individuals who would like to be brokers of selling this khabith to others so that they lure them into difficulties and challenges. Uthman radiallahu anhu reports to us a story from Bani Israel in which he said, "Abid was devoted in his ibadah to Allah Azza wa Jal. And a woman had been attracted to him, and she knew that she could not seduce him and lure him to do the ma'asiyah with her. So she looked into an indirect way to lure him to the ma'asiyah. So she sent her servant and told him that we would like you to come home to testify on something that will be taking place." And the abid took the innocent request from the servant and went with her to home. And as he walks into doors, she would lock the doors behind securely until he ended up going to the bedroom, and she said to him, "We did not invite you to testify or to be a witness, but rather we invited you for three things. You either commit the ma'asiyah of zina, or you either kill a child, an infant, or you drink al-khamr, alcohol." And in his assessment, he figured that the least would be to drink al-khamr, and we know the rest of the story, many of us. When he drank al-khamr, then his mind was camouflaged, and then eventually he killed the child and committed the ma'asiyah of zina. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Al-khamr ummul khaba'ith," the mother of all evil. And the same is to be applied to addiction, which is the most threatening problem to us as Canadians. I'm talking about as Canadians living in this beautiful country that is called Canada, according to the RCMP. The most challenging problem they have and they're dealing with is drugs. And we're all the time being labeled as terrorists, and we're all the time being put in the hot spot as a community. Rather than accusing Muslims and Islam, see what Islam has to offer to you. See what Islam has to give you. And let's work accumulatively, because our own children are being victims of drugs and alcohol, unfortunately. And we do have members of our community who are mental health patients, and we would like to be able to help them. Rather than using this dysfunctional health system that we have that is based on medication, we would like to offer an alternative in which we welcome the mental health patients to warm hearts and open arms that embrace them and give them the emotional and support that is needed for them to be able to keep going in their life, which is proven by research to be far more effective than medication. That's what we need to stand up for and speak out loudly, rather than being all the time being subjugated as victims, and rather than being all the time being labeled, and rather than all the time either playing the victim role or the defendant role. You need to stand up and be yourself as a Muslim who's proud of his faith, that can offer something to resolve the problems in the societies in which we're living in. This is what we need to do, and this is how we need to deal with the issues we're having in. Yes, indeed, we do have some of our children who are drug addicts. And rather than kicking them from home, and rather than saying that you dishonored my family, you're no longer my child, you're out of my house forever. That's it. I don't need you. I don't know you. Why? Why are you giving him an easy target, making him an easy target of shaitan, rather than saying to him, let's work together. What problems do you have? So we can take you from A to B, to B safely, so that you can come back again to the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal said to us in the Quran, "Inna ya ayyuha alladhina amanu." When Umar al-Khattab said, "Ya Rasulullah, I pray to Allah to give us a clear answer about khamr." Umar al-Khattab, in his wisdom, after he became Muslim, al-Faruq, he realized that al-khamr is as evil. And he wants Allah to give a clear guidance on al-khamr. And then Allah Azza revealed this, al-khamr wal-maisir fi ma ithmun kabirun. Said, "Ya Allah, still, it's not clear. We need to have more clear answers, more clear guidance on how to deal with khamr." And then Allah Azza revealed in Surah An-Nisa, "Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, la taqrabu as-salata wa antum sukara hatta ta'lamu ma taqulun." Do not approach salah while you're under intoxication, until you're able to recognize what you are saying. So that for 5 times a day you need to be sober to and not engage into alcohol consumption so that you're able to stay awake and sober to be able to worship Allah Azza wa Jal. And Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was still saying, Ya Allah, give us a clear guidance on khamr. And then Allah Azza wa Jal revealed in the Quran, إنما الخمر والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام رجس من عمل الشيطان فاجتنبوه لعلكم تفلحون إنما يريد الشيطان أن يوقع بينكم العداوة والبغضاء بالخمر ويصدكم عن ذكر الله وعن الصلاة فهل أنتم منتهون الله أكبر. Then Allah has gradually, after he got the Sahaba to intellectually realize that al-khamr is a problem. There is a problem. Unless we realize as a society that drugs is a problem, because drugs is available, even though illegally available in the market, and in the perception of so many teens, including our Muslim teens, they think there is nothing wrong with trying drugs. There's nothing wrong with having a joint of marijuana because it makes you feel good. There is nothing wrong with experimenting with different drugs that are available in the market, because this is what youthhood is all about. Enjoy your life. This is the perception that exists in this society. Unless this perception changes, then we will not be able to deal with the problem. And then after that, Allah Azza wa Jal behaviorally asks us to abstain, to ask the Sahaba to abstain from khamr and from intoxication, from drugs, from addiction, until the time come and said to them, enough, period, and let's terminate it. May Allah help us to be able to understand our deen and help us to be guidance to others around us and help our children to be guided. Allahumma ameen. Inna Allahumma malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Wa barik Allahumma ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim fil alameen. Innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma inna abiduka abna'u abidika abna'u imaika nawasina biyadika maadhan fina hukmuka adlan fina qadauka. Nas'aluka Allahumma bikul ismin huwa laka sammayta bihi nafsak. أنزلته في كتابك أو علمته أحدا من خلقك أو استأثرت به في علم الغيب عندك بأن تجعل القرآن العظيم ربيع قلوبنا يا الله. اللهم اجعله جلاء لهمومنا وأحزاننا يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم يا مقلب القلوب والأبصار ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. اللهم إن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. اللهم هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. اللهم اغفر لوالدينا وارحمهما كما ربيانا صغيرا.